Very good morning, dear participants. It is our privilege and honor to welcome each and every one of you to this first session for day two of the NHRDN Mind Matters Initiative. As you may know, there is an entire vast set of offerings that we have put together as part of the Mind Matters Week, which we celebrate whole of this week. This is a list of the various organizations that have signed up for this initiative. In course of the past few weeks, we have been working with each of these organizations who have signed up to help them with their entire mental health policy, be it drafting one in case there wasn't one already present, to an entire kit that is available for the organization to present to their employees. And importantly, there is a set of offerings that we have collaborated with LinkedIn for. It is on courses around mental health, which is available to anyone who would like to avail of the same. We also have a certification program, which we refer to as the Mind Matters Ambassador Certification. This is going to be run tomorrow, first half, for 3 hours. For a limited number of organizations from each of the organizations that have signed up, a few team members from each organization that has signed up. This is a list of the courses, that are offered by LinkedIn, available free of cost for organizations, team members who would like to avail of this during this week. And a little after too. So do reach out to us in case you would like to avail of this. Take a look at this glimpse of various offerings that we have planned for you over this week. We have concluded 3 sessions yesterday. They range from sessions around basic awareness about mental health awareness, as well as sessions where you get inputs in terms of how to practice bring these various aspects to take care of stress and manage your mental health better. And the highlight clearly is a set of deep dive sessions, which deals with, as you see, these topics that are listed on the screen, right from suicide and self-harm, which was dealt with yesterday. We intend to talk about gender and sexuality in the workplace today, and a lot of others, including substance use, depression, anxiety, eating disorders, and so on. And there would also be a lot of story sharing of people who have been through life-changing experiences and how they've actually managed to deal with some of these very trying circumstances that they've been put through. A few ground rules before we begin the session today. We would mute all lines to ensure that we are able to focus and tell you on what is being discussed. In case you have questions, please ask, raise your hand virtually, of course, and we will also give you an option to type in your questions. We would love to take them towards the end of the session. We will also share a feedback form with you. We seek your feedback to ensure that we are able to align our offerings in line with what you might want and what would be really useful to participants. And do follow us on social media so that you don't lose out or miss out on a lot of offerings. Before we begin the rest of the proceedings, which is primarily around a survey that we conducted on mental wellness, I am very proud to invite the speakers for the day. I would request Srini sir, Srinivas Udumula, who is the Chief People Officer of Bharat Financial Inclusion Limited. And along with him, Dr. Runa Mehta and Dr. N. Shekhar, who are the presenters and who really held this entire research and put the findings together along with help from NDIM. Over to you, Srini sir.
Yep. Thank you, Nisha. Wonderful. I welcome all of you who have joined us this morning, and a big welcome to all of you. And Before I walk you through the slide, which is self-explanatory, but still, you know, this is a cause we, as a part of the NHRD board, wanted to let you know it's pretty close to our heart. That's the reason we are putting in enormous amount of effort in this regards. We're running this campaign. The team has been working for a month or so in putting together the campaign. Why is mental health a significantly important aspect for us, our mental well-being? Like all of us know about the iceberg philosophy, right? There's only little you can see about the surface of the water, but you know, in magnitude of proportion, you know, there's so much which is below it. Right? What we see in terms of physical imbalance or physical health issues is a very significantly small component which impacts people in terms of their productivity and their well-being. Whereas the mental well-being is something which is unseen and people can't see it physically. That's something, you know, which is significantly important because that impacts close to the research survey shows saying that roughly around 22 to 27% of the productivity impact is because of the mental well-being issues. And the causes could be many. We're not sitting here to debate about the causes. The reason why we thought this is important is this is one significant aspect. If the corporate India can get its act right, I think we would have solved a problem which is going to have a significant impact on the triple bottom line for the organizations. So we all felt saying that we should go back and check what is the status of the nation in terms of what's happening in the corporate world today in terms of mental well-being and the best practices and what they are doing about it and what are the hurdles. And we took a survey. We had 82 CHROs who responded to our survey. The team will walk you through the in-depth analysis of the survey and what are the different aspects and what have we found. Very, very interesting observations have come out. And I'll share a few of them. The team will walk you through in more detail about each one of them. It's significantly important because one way you can also understand where we are as a start line and also you understand some of the leading practices here being followed in some of the organizations. 63% of the organizations have come back and said that they do have a mental health program, but 30% of the organizations have said they don't have any. That's something which is important because we need to recognize and say that this is important and pay forward. 49% of the organization felt that either lack of readiness for the mental health programs as there's a significant amount of stigma attached to the whole thing. And if you look at the next block, which is about why do employees do not open up about their mental health problems. So this is where the crux of the problem is. You know, social stigma is something which actually makes significantly large amount of employees, you know, almost overwhelming one third of the people have said saying that social stigma is something which actually stops people from sharing what they wish to share in terms of their health they require. The next big thing in that is lack of awareness. People don't recognize that there could be mental impact which could be impacting their work and the productivity. Awareness is another significant reason. And then it goes on to show there's a misconception and then there is an attitude of superiors and colleagues, which is another significant thing in terms of creating a great mental health and safe place to work. If you look at the next most important thing, it's about what is causing actually post-COVID, why do we think? We all think that, you know, post-COVID, the need for mental well-being and focus on mental health is need to be, you know, multiplied because stress levels have gone up significantly. That's what the CHROs have said. Overwhelming 22% of the CHROs have said. We believe post-COVID, we need to give high priority to mental health because the stress levels are higher. Remote work syndrome is causing more issues. Uncertainty of the future is a significant thing which is going to impact the mental well-being of the people, the mental balance of the people, and the social connection. This is what the CHROs have said. We acknowledge the same. We believe that these are important things to address. Next comes important thing. What do companies do today if somebody comes and reports a problem and say, look, I have an issue, either I'm feeling depressed or I'm feeling lack of confidence. What do companies do today? 27% of the CHROs have said first thing they do is that they ask the individual to go and meet the HR person. Another overwhelming one-fourth of the people said, speak to a counselor. They are the organization which have an EAP service provider. So they direct the individual to speaking to a counselor. And another set of people said third-party expert. They advise them to go and meet a third-party expert. Few organizations have hotlines, which is what the organizations have encouraged the employees to go and seek. Broadly, this is the thing. We understand what has come out is that most of the organizations do not have a proper framed mental health program. We believe that's a need of the hour. The significant reason why people don't want to open up, and also the organizations find as a stumbling block in terms of having a proper mental health program, stems from two things. One is there's a significant amount of social stigma, which obviously we need to work with. That means people should be able to come up and open. And if you look at our tagline, we also said, ask, listen, and share, right? So you ask for help. So people should be able to come up and ask for help. The second significant thing is about lack of awareness that a mental health issue can cause impact. Awareness around the mental health, curable, it's something you can openly ask for help. That's fundamental in terms of creating a mental health safe workplace. We believe post-COVID, and this is what most of CHRs have said, post-COVID, the need for a stronger focus on mental well-being is important because the stress levels are higher, the changed work relationships, remote working, these are putting more stress on the people and which requires us to handle this differently. And we talked about some of the best practices. The team is going to walk you through that. But once again, we wish to thank all the CHROs who have given us the responses. We believe this is a journey. We're starting today. And we expect to make good progress in the coming days to come, working closely with the organizations. And we wish to carry out a similar survey, maybe after a period of time, to know where we're going to stand. And that will define us the charter for NHRD going forward. Now, over to Nisha to take it forward. Thank you, Nisha. Thank you, team.
Thank you indeed, sir. I must add that we are very fortunate to have the likes of you and Murthy, sir, as people who are leading from the front. Both of you, Srini, sir, has just taken over as chapter president, Hyderabad. Murthy, sir, leads very exemplarily the Hosur chapter. We are very glad that we have the likes of you who are leading from the front for initiatives as important as this, sir. Thank you indeed. May I now request Runa ma'am to please begin with the survey on mental wellness.
Thank you, Nisha. Thanks to entire NHRD and team, Krish Shankar for giving us the opportunity and Shrini for setting the tone today. A few months ago, Dr. Shekhar and I sat together and we were designing this survey, and we thought, what is it we are looking for to add value and ensure that we get the right kind of input from the CHROs, and we also make it very meaningful as a survey, not only for the entire Mind Matters Ask, Listen, and Share program, but also the outcome should be valuable to the audience. Today, we thank you all for joining us and enabling us to share the findings, and we are absolutely eager to know what you think. And for that, we would have a question answer session. So we have our esteemed panelist, Murthy sir and Shini sir would also join us then to help us. So, resolve any query if you may have. Before that, as Shini has put together, that me and Dr. Shekhar would be going deeper into the survey and would share step by step how we had got the outcome of the, very significant designed questionnaire we had put to the CHROs, and we're very lucky a good number of people and good number of organizations had joined us and shared their thoughts. So we would like to thank all the CHROs who helped us to put it together. So the first slide which we have It talks about the background. You would like to share the introduction so that you are on the same page. So we wanted to discuss about the current situation. So the current situation, of course, it relates to the pandemic era, but mental health definitely had been a question mark for a lot of time. A lot of initiatives have taken, but we can all see that it has increased. So possibly this is a time we, you know, get together and work on this area. So what we see that it's resulting in restriction on mobility and social interaction has created a lot of insecurity among individual, leading to a possible spike in mental health problems. So that is exactly what I meant when I said the pandemic had talked about the spike. While some organizations have established mechanisms to cope with the situation, many are looking to establish new processes to overcome the situation and help employees in managing their mental health. As a representative professional association, NHRDN has taken this responsibility upon itself to assist the companies in managing this serious matter. Leading up to the International Mental Health Day on 10th October 2020, a week dedicated to promoting awareness of mental health issues to help organizations was envisioned as a great way to bring due attention to this worthy cause and to set a mental well-being movement rolling. So that's exactly what Nisha has shared when she started the session today. The objective is to highlight problems faced by employees and employers, and also showcase good practices in several organizations in this area. This way, we hope to be able to increase awareness on key issues pertaining to mental health and well-being and identify areas where we need to build capacity to help manage the situation. This is exactly the reason we brought together the survey done with CHROs, and also we had got responses of employees through various other means, for example, LinkedIn and social media. So in this connection, a survey was conducted to help identify key challenges and issues in this space so that organizations can plan their communication and awareness building initiatives appropriately. The summary of findings is detailed in the presentation. However, I wanted to, in the next slide, share the methodology. So this is the overview of finding. This survey was conducted among CHROs, as we mentioned, across India to find out the preparedness of industry to face the mental health issue post-pandemic, the problems faced and best practices in certain organizations. The survey helped us to identify measures to raise awareness on mental health and also assist in building the capacity of companies to assist their employees to overcome mental health issues. A total of 82 organizations shared their views on the matter raised, and we could actually put together this, you know, finding from the 82 organization in a stipulated time. So over to Dr. Shekhar to share these outcomes.
Can you unmute Sagar?
Shekhar, we can't hear you. You have to speak into the microphone.
You can unmute yourself. No, not audio.
We can't hear you. I think you should take off the earphones and then take out from the laptop and speak.
Direct. Yeah. Better.
Unmute.
He seems to be unmuted already.
Yeah. We can hear you. Go ahead. No, we can't. No. Okay.
Not able to hear.
Okay, would you, Dr. Runa, why don't you continue with the presentation while he figures out? Yeah, go ahead.
Sure, and we can catch up with Dr. Shekhar once this is taken care. So thank you for that. And Dr. Shekhar, I'll take it forward with your permission. So the summary of findings which we see on our screen, that when you look at the current status of preparedness, around 63% of companies, as Srini has already mentioned, have some kind of programs, while 30% do not have any kind of programs, and the remaining 7% have just initiated some kind of programs, probably due to the need of the hour. When asked about barriers to mental wellness programs, the readiness of employees to participate in the program mattered the most, followed by stigma around mental health issues and, of course, the cost factor. Other minor barriers included deficiency of resources and staff to maintain the program. That's very crucial. Mixing personal and workplace issues, young workforce, manager mindset, lack of knowledge in initiating the program, and availability of tools and professional help to continue. The next point is that regarding the factors affecting the mental health of employees, work-related pressure seemed to be the major factor, followed by relationship issues, physical health, habits, and economic issues in the same order of importance. Remote work, isolation, and loneliness due to pandemic also contributed to mental illness. So COVID has affected the mental health of employees in the following ways: increase in stress levels, uncertainty about the future, remote work syndrome, lack of social connectivity, job security, managing energy levels, safety, and managing manager support. We have some more findings in the next slide. So companies have tried different methods to encourage their employees to open up about their mental issues and seek help. The most important ones are speaking to an HR representative, interacting with psychology counselors or an outside expert, 24/7 hotlines, Dropbox, and Ombudsman also worked. Employees have different reasons for not opening up on their mental health issues. While social stigma is the main hurdle, lack of awareness, misconception, the attitude of supervisors and colleagues, and the absence of a reliable supporting system in organizations also prevented employees from seeking help. Measures taken by companies to protect the mental health of employees during pandemic included communicating regularly with employees, providing support for remote work, creating awareness on mental health, physical fitness program, medical help, support for hospitalization, coaching and counseling programs, providing psychological support, social activities, economic changes, financial benefits, and extending transport facility in the same order of importance. Okay, the next slide. Dr. Shekhar, would you like to take or should I continue? I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, are you there? No, I can't see him, so I can't see him.
Yeah. Troubleshooting. Also, I think he's dropped off.
Yeah, he's dropped off. All right, so I think the findings more or less probably resonating with our audience, and we are very, very thankful to the participant that they have authentically shared those data points, which probably we are hearing around us. But when you do a survey, you get actual data. That is where the whole, you know, honest feedback is important. So the, you know, critical part is to go ahead, ensure that we also recover from this situation. So we got a lot of insight on best practices. So let me share those best practices which has been followed by the organization. Probably these are the benchmarks we can take forward with us in the future. So the first best practice let me share with you is employee assistance program, where they offer 24/7 counseling. This is very important because we are part of this global setup, and our employees are working across the time schedule. So 24/7 possibility is something which is very, very useful. One-to-one counseling support with professionals, counselors, third-party support. So a lot of third-party companies came forward and offered this expertise to the companies. Online counseling to COVID-19 positive employees and family members on-site help availability. I think this is very critical at the current situation. Annual health checkup, personalized medical consultation through an external party. Practice yoga every day, laughter yoga, meditation. All this had been part of the day-to-day activity, which helped. Periodic workshop on mental wellness to uplift motivation levels, knowledge channels on health and mental health, learning. There are a lot of learning offerings were also shared with the people. A lot of edutech companies came forward. Awareness sessions, video on coping with stress and uncertainty, podcast on wellness, irrelevant topics, etc. on the relevant topics has happened. Sorry about the word irrelevant. On the relevant topics has happened. Overall wellness tips, physical, mental, social well-being tips for food, meditation, all this had been offered by the organization as best practice. So can we go to the next? Yeah. So what are the differentiators? A lot of good practices we got to know. We learned from that. We are still learning. But there are certain differentiators we must know possibly, which are going to help us a lot of insight our guidelines. Something like Open Sesame on unstructured, no agenda R, where employees can talk anything of concern, except business. So that is one of the best practices we learned. Connectivity, connecting every employees and along with their family members. This is very exceptional because the way we have seen the work from home scenario, family is part and parcel now. Nisha, there is some other screen I can see. Yeah, thanks. So special focus on ergonomics while working from home, nutrition focus while working from home. I think this became one of the critical area. So people really, really went up out of their box and started helping out how to improve the economy, which because sitting long time were really, really hampering the health. Then confidentiality and privacy insurance, because people are working only through laptop, telecom, the cybersecurity, data security became primary point. Empowerment to say no. That is, I think, very, very crucial. Arrangements for cashless COVID-19 testing and treatment of COVID insurance, leave. In fact, a lot of leave policy changes happened. Then counseling and quarantine facility. Managers coaching to identify red flags, trainings of leaders and people managers. I think this became very crucial as part of the learning improvement and learning possibilities. Each one, reach one, peer-to-peer counseling. This is one of the best practices we learned from our respondents. New innovative ways to emerge, engage the millennials. I was reading the last point. Nisha, can we go back? Yeah. Okay. So we were talking about how to engage the millennial crowd through various sessions and also ensuring something like, dance program, dance movement therapy, then a lot of such activities or meditation, etc. These are the differentiators we learned from the survey. Yeah. Next slide, please. So we also wanted to give some insight through graphical representations. What are the barriers on a mental well-being program? So we can see that, the distribution of the program on readiness to participate in program, stigma around mental health issues, cost, there are also, we also said others so that we could get the verbatim. And some also said no idea where to start with the implementation. There were lack of staff to support, lack of resources to maintain the program. So I think we could see that, the maximum point where we got is the stigma around mental health issues. People are not coming forward. So 23% of people actually talked about that, and 26% are not, you know, talked about readiness to participate in the program. That is where they had little issue. Yeah, can we go to the next slide? So efforts to encourage opening up about mental issues. I think this chart gives us a reflection about how much effort has been put and how, you know, people were encouraged. So we can see that, you know, 25.73% speak to counselor out of the participants. And that is something is a good insight, that because speaking to counselor definitely helps. Then we have 26.90% who are actually connecting to HR representatives. All right, so that's how they're encouraged to connect to either counselors or HR representatives. And as we said, that people brought in, the organization brought in the third party experts. So 21.64% were connected and they were engaged through third party experts. Similarly, there are some distributions around hotline, Dropbox, and ombudsperson. But there is a significant amount of efforts which is happening as 7.60%, as others. People are experimenting various measures, and that data is dispersed. So we have not put those data points in the chart, but people are innovative. They are continuously thriving to encourage their employees to open up. Yeah, the next slide.
Runa, can I continue?
Yes, welcome. I was looking at your name, whether you're there. Yeah, thank you. Please continue.
Okay. So continuing with the presentation, reasons for employees not opening up regarding their mental health problems. The main finding here is that there is a social stigma. So people are afraid of what others think, what our peers, co-employees think. So they are not coming with their issues and seeking help from the company. That is the main issue. That this is followed by lack of awareness that mental health is a small issue and it can be curable with expertise help. So if you approach companies, you can speak to a counselor or third party or even the HR there and get it cured. So that awareness is not there. So that is the next big bottleneck. Next, attitude of superiors and colleagues. They don't have empathy to the person facing the problem, and that sort of issues are also there. And there is misconception regarding mental health. Mental health problems can be many. It can be a simple problem to a large problem. So that misconception about every mental health problem is a lunaticism or something like that, that is also an issue. Then lack of supporting system in organizations. Most organizations do not have a very good setup. When a person has a mental health problem, he should first go to a HR or a counseling system or a Dropbox, some such ready-made system where he can put in his problem and get proper help, and that too in a confidential manner. So that kind of setup is not there in most companies. That is also a problem. So these are the problems identified for employees not opening up on their mental health issues. So next slide. So what are the different reasons for mental health issues faced by the employees? The main reason is work stress. So there is too much of work, either he is not able to cope up with the amount of work and meet the tough deadlines, and he is not able to discuss it with his superiors, all these problems. Next, due to this pandemic, people are forced to work from home. So there is this new syndrome called remote work syndrome. He has to sit in his home and work for long hours. And due to this pandemic, the number of hours working has increased for most of the people. That is also a problem. Next, there is uncertainty of future. So due to this pandemic, there is loss of sales. There is a lot of restructuring, people losing jobs, and people are not certain about their future. So that is also a problem. Next, this is social connection. People are working on their own. They are not able to meet their friends, have a chit chat, share their issues. All this is not happening. There is no social connection. So people are affected by this. Next, there is no job security. then managing energy, sitting back in a home for and working for long hours. Now the number of working hours has increased from 8 to 10 to some 12 to 14 hours, which is not happening. Next, there is no support from the manager because we are regularly interacting with the manager. So there is no support from the manager, or manager is also not in a mindset to evaluate the work and give the necessary support from time to time. Next, the safety, job safety, all these things. So these are the issues faced by employers, which is found out from this survey. Next slide. And what are the measures taken by the companies to protect the mental health of the employees? So the number one measure is communication. This is very important. Regularly communicating with your employees, telling them what are the measures taken by the owners to protect their health, what are the facilities they are extending, if they have a problem, whom they should approach. All these things we have to communicate to employees from time to time. That is also important. Next, providing support for remote work. When they are working remotely, you have to provide them support because in terms of good network. If necessary, they have to be delivered food and all these things. Next, providing mental health awareness. There are a lot of problems coming up now on mental health. So people should be made aware that it can be cured if taken with proper help. Then coaching and counseling. So offering them good counseling and coaching help through the HRs or other experts in the organization itself. And if they are not comfortable with it, involving some third party, outside counselor. Next, psychological support, speaking to the people who are in problem, giving them opportunity to discuss with their peers, friends. Next, physical fitness program. This physical fitness is also important thing because if you are physically fit, most of your mental problems are away. So if you are physically fit and working, so mental problems normally won't come to you. Next, social activity. You have to mix with people, you have to share your problems, you have to share their problems, you have to party, all these things are there. Then ergonomical changes, transport facility, providing transport facility and some special financial benefits for remote working. Then there is special reward for remote work and office work. Some organizations are even offering this special rewards for working from home and working remotely. So companies have taken so many measures to protect their mental health of the employees. Next slide.
Shankar, Dr. Shankar, yeah. You have to just close it in the next minute or two. So just rush to the next two slides so that people can ask questions. Yeah.
Okay. And apart from CHROs, we have also asked employees also to present their side of the picture. So these are the findings. So some of them are taking help from the organizations. They are attending stress management workshops. They are seeking help from the counselor and all the facilities offered by the company they are taking, and they are able to cope with the mental illness problems. Next slide. So to conclude, communication is the most important thing. You keep these are the main conclusions from this finding. You have to communicate regularly with employees. You have to try and remove the stigma from their mindsets. Then you have to take the help of some outside counselors and psychologists and help the employees to come out of their mental health issues. And HR should start acting as a full and helpful friend. And also the employees must be helped to identify the symptoms and come forward and take the help of the persons available for counseling and coaching and able to clear their problems. So these are the conclusions of these findings. Thank you. Next, Isha will, madam, will continue.
Thank you indeed, sir. A very comprehensive overview of what we found in terms of the findings as part of the CHRO as well as the employee survey. There are a few questions that have come in from the participants. With everyone's permission, would you like me to take a look at a couple of them? Time permitting.
Before that, we have. Can we ask Mr. Murthy to give you idea about this research?
Yeah, exactly. Absolutely. In fact, Nisha, it will be very important, you know, useful. If the questions we can ask Mr. Murthy and Rashini sir. Before we start the questions, maybe Murthy sir, if you know, considering the survey we just shared, if you can share some view of yours.
Sure, sure. So my role is very simple, to just give the feedback about this whole exercise, what you people did. Firstly, you know, my appreciation to the team for this, you know, set of questionnaires what you framed to get this result. That's more important. Normally the set of questions is very important. So to that extent, I think the team worked well. That is the reason we are able to get this much relevant data. Here, surprisingly, the HR manager's role, it is very much predominantly highlighted in the survey. About 27% of the people, they do the counselor role in most of the organization. In the sense, MSME category industry, they cannot have a full-time counselor or third-party role. Most of the time, MSME category, they won't HR people, they act like a counselor. In such case, I think we have to think of some kind of certification program exclusively for HR people on this mental awareness related specialization, how they have to equip themselves to counsel their team. That's more important. And this, normally the 4th March safety day, how it is become popular among all Indian industry. That way, I think the way in which this initiative is taken by the central team, this journey has to continue year after year, so that it's not one day or one week exercise. And we, in order to maintain this awareness all along, I think every year we should maintain this mental health day celebration kind of thing, so that the coming years, definitely this mental well-being becoming a very important topic under employee wellness program. We can focus and take it forward for more beneficial to the employees across the corporates. Thank you. Over to Nisha.
Thank you indeed, sir. If I may quickly, there is one question which might actually be the crux of the entire reason we brought this initiative into being. There is a participant who says employees are not comfortable in sharing their mental health to the human resources team because of fear of losing their job. So may I request the eminent panelists here to tell us our view on a possible solution to this?
Yeah, so thank you for the question. Yes, I'll broad-base that, not just to not open to share with HR, but I guess with the manager or anybody in the company. Yeah, the fear of stigma and how that information will be used is always going to be in the mind of an employee. That's why they don't end up sharing, or they don't trust or confide in the people. This is the point of the change has to come from the top. We have described, if you see in our kit, we kind of talked about the first mailer going from the CXO's desk, the CEO or the CHRO's desk, really affirming that the organization wishes to be a mental health as a priority and a safe place for people to be able to have those conversations. The organization must make significant effort to be able to create a place for where people can come openly and share their views. That's fundamental. Second is, I agree, people may have challenge in working with HR, but it's not about whom they share with. I think it's basically whomever they can confide in. So organizations encourage employees to go and reach out to those people whom they can confide in. It could be an external counselor which the organization can provide as a help. It could be a manager, or it could be a peer who could be a good sounding board for them. But what our request is going to be, organizations should make an effort to make sure that we send that information out, and said we are not going to use this information, people will treat it confidentially, and it will not be used negatively against the employee. Second is also encourage employees to come out openly and share. If you look at our posters in terms of pledge, the pledge which we want every employee to take, and we would encourage all the organizations to take that pledge and actually have every employee take the pledge, is which clearly turns around and says what is the responsibility of the individual for their own mental health and well-being, also what they should be doing for their peers, and in terms of making it a safe place for people to encourage, have those conversations. So unless you create enabling environment, it will be difficult for people to be opening up and sharing these things. This is our thing. And it need not be that people have to go to HR. It could be anybody whom they can confide in. So it could be a counselor, it could be a manager, it could be a colleague, it could be even HR. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Runa, ma'am, any closing thoughts from you? Because we're out of time.
I think we are on time, so I would restrict it to a point that I think it's a journey, and we are still looking at a lot of measures to be taken to combat this situation. What helped us to learn the great initiatives taken by the CHROs and their HR team in the organization, and the support to look into betterment of employees and work with lesser stress, being feeling safe and able to focus on productivity. I think that's most important. So let's work towards that.
And also use the tools provided by this Mind Matters team.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you all. We regroup in another 15 minutes or so. Look forward to continued participation from all the organizations who have signed up and otherwise. Thank you all and have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.